Welcome back, everybody. As you know, we are in live from Chennai. So FinTech Festival India, Chennai, micro experience. And when we are in Chennai, how can we not talk about the fintechs from Chennai itself? While Chennai is known as the country's SaaS center, there is a significant opportunity for the city to capitalize on its excellent banking infrastructure and IT expertise to emerge as a leader in SaaS plus finance. With Tamil Nadu government's plans to establish a fintech city and Nandambakkam, it has given a new direction and a different dimension to the fintechs from the state. Our next session, which is Fintechs from State of Tamil Nadu, is moderated by Thirumathi Pooja Kulkarni, IAS and Managing Director and Chief Executive Officer of Guidance Tamil Nadu, who will be joined by Mr. Prabhu Rangarajan, co-founder of M2P Fintech, Mr. Ramanan SV, Chief Executive Officer India and South Asia, Intellect Design Arena Limited, and Mr. Solomon Ashok, founder of Cast.com. But that's not all. Before we start this discussion, Thirumathi Pooja Kulkarni, IAS, and our other speakers will be launching a white paper on Chennai, a hub for SaaS startups. Over to you, Pooja ma'am.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Good afternoon, all.
Good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
Just to set the context for this discussion. So, Tamil Nadu, as we all know, is the second largest economy in India. And the financial services sector has always been a leading sector for the state. We have had a long history. Many of us may not know that the Madras Bank was actually set up as far back as 1682. And since then, we had the Imperial Bank of Madras, which is one of the precursors to State Bank of India. This is not the only one. We've had large public sector banks set up in the state, the Indian Bank, the Indian Overseas Bank. Very many private sector banks, Tamil Nadu Mercantile, City Union, Karur Vysya, you name a few. And then, of course, the NBFC sector. They have not been far behind either. The leading NBFCs in the country, whether it is Cholamandalam or Sundaram, Shriram, to name a few, they have all made the state proud in the services that they offer. And coming to the tech part, Chennai has always been at the forefront of software, and it is now, of course, known as the SaaS capital of India. So whether it is tech or fin, Chennai and Tamil Nadu have been at the forefront of both these sectors. And what more can we ask for than a happy amalgam of the fin and tech legacy of the state for Chennai and the state to become the fintech capital of India? We are poised to become a fintech hub, a leading global fintech hub. Lot of initiatives that the government itself is taking. We are going to be setting up a fintech city at Nandambakkam in phase one, and as it grows, we will be expanding. We would also set up a fintech center of excellence. There is already FinBlue in the state. We will also be launching a fintech policy. In guidance, we have already established a fintech cell to nurture and facilitate fintech startups as well as large fintech companies in the state. And we would also engage continuously with the industry for fintech talent development, engaging the industry, connecting the industry with academia and the educational institutions to promote and further talent development. Today, it's a pleasure that I have with me three fintech companies which are from Tamil Nadu, and they have started their journeys in the state at various points of time. The senior most being Intellect Design Area, going as far back as 10 years. I have Mr. Ramanan, who is the India CEO for Intellect Design. On my left is Mr. Prabhu Rangarajan, co-founder of M2P Fintech. And we have Mr. Solomon Ashok, the newest fintech of the lot. He is founder and CEO of Cash. So just to briefly introduce, we start with Intellect Design. So you are now a publicly listed company, and a market cap, you are boasting of a market cap of nearly 10,000 crores today. A large number of employees, most of them based out of Chennai. So, Mr. Ramanan, could you just give a brief on how you started your journey, and what is it that the state and the city have done to help you further your business?
Thanks, ma'am, and pleasure meeting all of you, part of this FinTech Festival, and sharing our thoughts about Tamil Nadu as a state and Chennai as a city for FinTech growth. Ma'am mentioned about Intellect's 10-year journey in the state, but actually the journey goes a little longer. It started in the early 90s when the group came to Chennai to support one of the largest banks of US in India, Citibank. That's the roots of the company, starting with supporting Citibanks on their technology journey, and then over a period of time growing in size, then divesting the services business to be a fintech product company. So the roots started as early as 1990s, and prior to the event I was sharing with ma'am, saying that people normally associate technology and cultural fitment to most people out of other states, but people who have once come to Chennai, they never want to leave the state. Okay, so that's the journey. Mr. Jain, who started the company, he and his family moved from Delhi. A few of the senior colleagues moved from Delhi, and they've all stayed put in the state. Coming to the journey, as you rightly said, we are a listed organization. The journey has been phenomenal. We have now grown to our direct presence in over 40 odd countries, our product presence in over 90 odd countries. We have practically employees from over 90 different countries working with us across the globe. But majority of them work out of our Chennai center. Chennai is the corporate office and center. Our journey has been fantastic. We launched the first design thinking center focused on finance called 8012. Any of you who are interested and who have an opportunity to come to Chennai, please do visit us at 8012. I will leave the thought at this stage as to why it is called 8012 now. When you come to the design center, you will figure it out. It's focused on finance, so that's the journey that we have gone through.
So Mr. Ramanan, you mentioned that you have employees from 90 countries working with you, and many of them are working in Chennai. So how has Chennai really helped you become and to position yourself functioning out of Chennai as the hub for all your global operations?
So typically when people want to work in an organization, they look for a few things. Okay, what's the technology that they're working on? What's the contribution, their contribution, how it's going to impact the world? So that way, Intellect has been able to satisfy them. Coming to why Chennai and how their thing, each of us have families, right? I mean, you look for a few things when you look for settling in a state or a city. You need good infrastructure. You need good schools for your children. You need healthcare facilities. Everything is available in a state like Tamil Nadu. Okay. The best thing is public transport is very effective. Your access to infrastructure is easily available. So it attracts talent. So that's how we've been able to. International employees, we don't have many in Chennai, but they operate in our other centers in London, New York, Singapore, Middle East. But Chennai surely has a cross-functional or cultural employees from across the country.
Thank you so much, Mr. Ramanan. Coming to you, Mr. Prabhu, so you have managed to successfully raise funding of late. And could you talk about what M2P FinTech does, and how did you choose to grow out of Chennai, and how has it helped you?
Sure, ma'am. Thank you. Thank you so much. Thanks for the organizers. Thanks for having me here. So it's been a worldwide journey. We are a 7-year-old startup based out of Chennai. We come with a very humble background. We are still humble in terms of the kind of people, the kind of team that we have built so far, it really excites us every day to go back to office and make wonders. So going back to our, the way we founded M2P, we the co-founders, the three of us, Madhu, Muthu and I, we have all been born and brought up in Chennai or Tamil Nadu. So we have spent a good amount of time in Chennai understanding the ecosystem. What we felt was there was a white space in banking where what companies wanted to build and launch in the market and what banks had to offer had a white space, and that's the reason M2P FinTech was born. We set out to build a layer of technology that connects the finance with the technology, and we also wanted to make sure that the wherewithal that our folks in Tamil Nadu have, because as you know, generally when it comes to finance, Mumbai is being referred as the finance capital. When it comes to technology, probably a Bangalore or a Hyderabad is referred as the technology capital. However, Chennai has all these things in a balance. We strike the right balance, we have the right folks. So we thought there is always people, process, technology. We thought, like, let's get the right people in the company, build good technology, meaningful technology, have process as part of our culture. And that's that's kind of worked for us. We have been able to kind of, so initially we started working with smaller banks. We built the technology, we grew with the products that we launched. We learned a lot of things, and then over time we have started working with all larger banks as well, and we have launched in 11 different markets today. Currently we have aspirations to step into 50 different markets by 2025. And we are a 500 strong team. That's what makes me more proud, because we were operating out of a 2 BHK apartment in Chennai back in 2014-15, and now we have offices across 7 locations. But Chennai is the actual hub. We have created, out of the 500 folks, we have 350 plus reporting in Chennai, and in fact we have aspirations to open office across Tamil Nadu, and make sure that the mindset that our folks have, the deep knowledge, the kind of effort they put in to understand problems and then come up with solutions rather than going with a shallow kind of an approach, has really worked for us. The team has put in hard yards. They've been really supportive. So here we are. And when we spoke to investors, they were able to relate to this depth that we have. What investors like to see is the kind of depth and the domain knowledge that we bring to the table, and that has really worked for us. And we've got a lot of inbound interest. And as a side note, most of the investors say that they feel happy talking to most of the Chennai startups, right? Whatever startups have sprung up in the last few years, they're quite happy. The feedback loop that we have, we keep hearing about all these startups arising out of Chennai have quite deep domain understanding, and they do their part really well. So here we are, ma'am.
Thank you, Prabhu. Really heartening to know that in a short span of time, you're able to establish your footprint not just in the state. It's great to know that you are spreading your operations to other cities across the state, but also across the globe. My congratulations to you.
Thank you, ma'am.
We have Mr. Solomon Ashok from Cash, who is the new kid on the block. So the two of them have successfully demonstrated that they have been able to raise funding. You are now in operations for about 1.5 years now. So could you tell us how difficult or easy it has been for you to, you know, really raise access funding, access the PE networks, the angel investors, if you could shed some light on that?
Yeah. Thank you, ma'am. I thank FinTech Festival for inviting us. And to give a small introduction about Cash, like, we are 1.5 years old FinTech company. And I landed Chennai in 2007 with a big dream of opening a company. And in 2007, I started my IT services as a fresher. After completing my BE, I started my IT services. So the roots are very strong in Chennai. So we are 15 years old company in Chennai. And this 1.5 years where we started developing a FinTech product, once the product was ready, and we were able to reach out to the customers that we already served, and most of the customers were very open to come and test a product which is 1 year old, and that is the ecosystem that we have developed. And once the customers were inside and were testing the product, and we reached out to the seed funding, and the seed investors were very much happy that we have already have a customer base when it's a 1 year old company. So most of the times, like, we'll be launching a beta version with a few team members, and we'll be doing some demo, and then we'll be coming out of a product. But when we launched, we were able to have close to 10 customers on the day of launch, and that was the ecosystem that we have in Chennai. And investors like that, because they want to see a company or a product where people using it then comes up with an idea or a project or a product where people don't use it. So that ecosystem helps us. And 2007, when I came to Chennai, I don't know how to open a company. I remember that there is a shop, Annachi Kada. It was there. I went to him and I asked him, Anna, can you help me how to open a company? And he is the one went to the proprietorship company, and he opened the company for me. So that helps me sustain till today. And I still have that proprietorship company because I don't want to close it, because that Anna created that for me.
Interesting.
So we are seeing world over, we are seeing a lot of action in the fintech space. The largest conglomerates, whether it is Google or WhatsApp, everybody is really establishing a very, very strong footprint. They already have. And in India too, they are making their presence really felt, whether it is with GPay or WhatsApp Pay and the like. So how do you, as local homegrown players, how do you think to compete against such global giants? What do you think that are your strengths which will help you not just survive but really grow in this hyper competitive market?
So let me see if I can take that first. And getting competition from across the globe, like Google and WhatsApp Pay, is important. That's specific to one segment of your finance, which is on the payment space. The world is moving towards what we believe is called as open finance. Previous version of that was open banking. Now it's going to open finance. I wanted to share one specific win that we had recently. This is in the Nordics region. Mm-hmm. They had one of the leading banks in the Nordics region wanted to refurbish their technology, if I can call that that. And they invited tech players from across the globe. 21 tech players participated. Evaluation running over 12 months. Finally, Indian tech, incidentally, Intellect won that. Okay. The key is that technology is democratized, right? It's not left to a few players. Okay. Solomon has as much access to technology as we have with 10 years of vintage as Google or Amazon has. Key is to identify what's the critical pain point, having the right domain expertise to use technology to address the thing. That what helps win you deals, and that's what is happening. So that's, I thought I will share. While they have big pockets, if you have the right domain expertise with the right technical skills, you can take on the biggies.
True. And I think I always think about this, ma'am. So we as a market, or India as a market, has abundance of potential. You can test out various products in various manners. We can always say, take a micro market. Initially, in our back in those days, 2015-16, we took Nanganallur as a micro market because our offices were there. We tested the QR solution, QR code as a solution. We tested it out. We were able to go to 50 shops who knew us, who knew our faces, understand how it works. It is quite frugal, right? Like, we always think about frugality. How can we cut costs, launch anything, test anything, keep the market quite close to your chest and see how it pans out. This is something that is not possible in various other markets, because every market is, say, for example, the reason why we raised funding was not to sustain the India business. It is basically our entire India operations is still sustainable. We raised funding to expand globally, expand our footprint, because in the other markets, if you have to do localization, if you have to test out certain things, it's quite expensive. So what our local players have to do to compete with the likes of Google or any big tech company is to actually think about the local market, build for the local market, make sure that it attends to the problem. And in that sense, I think all our companies have been doing really well. What works in India will easily work anywhere else in the world. That's the mantra.
So I faced like when we were into IT services and we were developing OTT solutions like Amazon Prime and Netflix, and people were used to YouTube and they learned everything from YouTube, how to use that, how to watch a video, how to give a like. So educating the people, end customer, is very important. And when these key players, they come into the market, automatically the education is happening. So we know what Google Play does. Everyone knows that, every shop, they know that. So when we build a product, it is easy for us to go and reach out to the customers when the big player is also there. And the trust factor, because when you go for wealth tech, trust factor is very important. Gold loan on an app and everything is very important. And these key players give us the trust factor from the people because they already tested the platform. So that helps us.
So about the fintech space in general, the most popular sub-vertical is probably the payment space. But then payments is not the only thing about fintech. There are so many sub-verticals with payments is, of course, there. There is the lending space, lending to not just large, but smaller merchants, smaller SMEs. There is the insurance space. There is the trading space, the investment space. So how do you think is the space in Tamil Nadu and Chennai? In among these sub-verticals, where do you think our strengths lie?
Sure. So I want to take from the Anachi Kada that we usually tell, like when I was a kid, we usually go to an Anachi Kada to buy groceries, and I pay them, my father and mother, like after receiving the salary at the end of the month, they go and pay them. So that is a BNPL model, buy now pay later model, that we have now. So we take inspiration which lies in us. So we do it every day, and that helps us to build a product, and that's what I think.
True. And in fact, most of the things that we used to do as a regular practice have now been intervened with technology. What AI is trying to do is to learn how we used to operate a couple of decades ago, right? The same BNPL model that he says has been part of our lives. We have gone to a nearby shop and there will be a small account book which will carry. The Anachi will write in the account book. So that's what BNPL is. Similarly, there are various other things, right? Say for example, in terms of insurance, we now see ACOs of the world and other insurance companies that have sprung up, which are solving a basic problem where people who don't understand insurance, people who don't understand a specific subject, how can you educate them? He touched upon the topic of educating users. If our users are quite knowledgeable, if you give access to the knowledge about a specific product to them, they take superb decisions, and our users are our prime validators.
So taking the cue from what both Solomon and Prabhu mentioned, there are enough and more opportunities, like you rightly said, ma'am. Let's take wealth tech as an example. Okay, the largest RTA in the mutual fund space in the country operates out of Chennai.
Yes.
Computer Age Management Services. Okay. Wealth tech need not necessarily mean somebody having crores of rupees. Okay,
true.
Can you invest your surplus amount in a medium that can give you better returns? Okay, that's what mutual funds is all about. If you are able to provide a solution that can help anybody to invest 50 rupees, 100 rupees, 500 rupees a month, you made it there. Okay, small tickets. I mean, the sachet shampoos started out of Tamil Nadu, right? Okay, people always looked at bottles, half a liter bottle, 1 liter bottle, and then there was an innovation that came in the form of sachet shampoos. Can you provide sachet investment opportunities? That could be one. Prabhu spoke about insurance. Most of the insurtech is on onboarding the customer. Can something be done in the services space? Can a claim settlement be faster? Health insurance. Okay, this is a pet peeve that I have always. You go check into a hotel and next day morning you want to check out, within a minute or two your checkout process is complete. You go, for whatever reason you are a caregiver, take somebody to the hospital, doctor says discharge the patient at 9 in the morning, easily it is 3 or 4 in the evening before you leave the hospital. Yeah. Because the billing process, the insurance process is
cumbersome,
so lengthy and cumbersome. Any disruption in this space, life will be, so there are enough and more opportunities. It's for us to grab. I'm sure with the large hospitals, chains, like Apollo out of Chennai, we can do some disruption in that space as well.
Interesting. So the state always boasts of its superior technical workforce. You know, we boast of the highest number of engineering colleges in the country, polytechnics, and generally the educational infrastructure in the state is good. Our education institutions have fared at the top in the recent NIRF rankings also. And these are spread across the state. They are not, you know, restricted to Chennai. So what I would like to pose to you is, while Chennai is of course seeing a lot of growth in the fintech space, what is it that we need to do to spread the same to the other cities, be it Coimbatore or Trichy, Madurai, which have an equally good talent pool? What is it that the state needs to do, and what kind of infrastructure does the sector need?
So may I?
Yeah.
So of the 350 odd folks that I spoke about at M2P who reports into the Chennai office, we have probably about 60 or 70 people properly based out of Chennai. Their origins have been in and around Chennai. The remaining 300 odd folks are based out of probably are from down south, like Trichy, Madurai, Erode, Coimbatore, Salem, Kanyakumari. So what these folks, so Zoho has proved that opening up an office in Tenkasi or a training center in Tenkasi or a satellite office, set of satellite offices across Tamil Nadu works wonders, right? So people want to be closer to home, work with freedom, work with, carry certain responsibilities. So the moment we create micro atomic units of companies across the spread, across the state, it will certainly help. It will certainly, people will find it easier to hone their skills because upskilling is one of the key areas for any growing company. And the key challenge that we see here is concentration of talent in a specific city. If we are able to distribute that across, like the pandemic has proved that, right? People working from home, most companies report that productivity has improved. When you give the accountability to the folks and make them self-born leaders or make them the advice, right advice, that you are a leader, you lead yourself, right? And that attitude is good enough for people to kind of come out of their cocoon and make sure that they contribute more. So I think distributing instead of concentrating in one city or again going for a secondary city, we should actually look at how can we take it to tier 2, tier 3 cities. That will pave the way for having a brighter Tamil Nadu.
Yeah, I would add small things, like everyone will agree that we have a brain drain on talents because we have a huge number of engineers, but most of the top level college students or which we wanted moving to other cities. And when we have a small hubs, I would say it's like a pod. When you have pod nearby their homes and they can even earn the same amount of money that they're getting in Bangalore or other big cities, and which they can get it in their own cities, I'm sure like the brain drain will come down. People will be more open to come and work in a small startups like us. So that, because we have to take a candidate, we need to nurture them, we need to train them, and we need to bring to a level. So that will be helpful for a startup ecosystem. So and we are moving as a startup ecosystem. We should be a startup capital. And that's what I vision as Tamil Nadu.
I believe we are in a catch-22 situation. Okay, I agree with Solomon that we are losing talent. It's a question of how do you attract talent. Just by opening a small center, will that retain talent? I'm not too sure. But one thing is very clear is that, I mean, you spoke about when you introduced Tamil Nadu, second largest GDP in the country, it's just not few cities, right? I mean, you have actually a development across the state. Infrastructure is available across the state. Power is available across the state. Good technology institutions are available across the state. So there ideally should not be any limitation to grow in each part of the state. What I believe we can do slightly differently to ensure first growth happens before we retain people is to, as part of the curriculum, so basic finance should be introduced as part of the curriculum, and then fintech introduction can also happen. Okay, simple things like how to file your returns, okay, tax returns. Okay, simple things like how and when to invest. Okay, what is insurance and when do you start taking insurance? This should be covered as part of the school curriculum so that people appreciate finance. And today's technology, so I mean, we were chatting up before the session, we are mechanical engineers, electrical engineers, non-computer engineers, everybody going there. Can we introduce a fintech program as part of the curriculum that people learn and appreciate what technology and finance can do to change lives? That can help in increasing the available pool. So some pool stays back in Coimbatore, Tiruchi, Salem, Madurai, and then once it grows to size, we can arrest the movement of talent.
So taking the conversation further from here, so we do have the technical talent available in the state, but I presume that fintech requires a certain specific sets of skills which are probably not really transacted in the curriculum today. So how is it that as a state initiative, we partner with industry? How would industry like to contribute to actually partnering with the academic institutions also to ensure that students are fintech ready when they come out?
Sure. So let me take that first and then like I mentioned, we have a design think center out of Chennai. We currently work with at least a dozen plus educational institutions on design thinking as a concept. Okay, so there's a 3-credit, 4-credit course in most of the institutions that we work with on design thinking. We are open as Intellect to start a fintech program along with the educational institutions. Okay. If it is with the blessings of the government and the universities, I think that will add value. So if the government takes the initiative, then we can work with the universities, create a 3-4 credit programs. Today, of the dozen institutions, most of them are autonomous institutions, so they are able to introduce the change. But if I want to do, I'm just taking a name, a government college of engineering in Salem, the process is much longer. Okay, so that is why there is a need for a government intervention. We'll be more than happy to work along with the government on that.
Sure. And I think internship opportunities, if it is created by mature companies and companies that have seen it all, we can actually guide students in their budding stage to do the right thing, right? So that is what is actually lacking. The students pass out of colleges and they are directionless. Can we show the right direction while they are actually performing the course? Like a 3-year course probably have 2 different types of internships, like one in the middle of the course, one at the end of the course. Let them learn the trick of the trade in the first internship. Let them do a proper project, put them in a real wild situation with a proper project in hand. Let them actually do. So currently it is all done like a formality. They have to finish off the project, submit the paper, get marks and pass out, right? Whereas when they come out and join a job or get into a company, they are lost. So can we train them? Like it's all about training. All of us have got trained in something or the other at several points of time. Can we get the students trained in several internship kind of opportunities? We are open to provide internship opportunities. We work with universities. If the government intervention is there, I think it will be like a win-win for everybody.
Just 1 second, Salman. I was speaking to somebody whose son is graduating out of IIIT. The last semester is full internship for a student. Mm-hmm. We should actually make that mandatory.
That's right.
Okay, the moment you do that, you create an employable pool of talent. Okay, that's the view.
So I would agree with both of them. Like I was like part of few organization that I go to school students, college students, and every weekend I spend time with them. Wow. So the one thing that I understood, like when you put marks, you have to do this intern and you get the marks. People are working for the marks and not for the knowledge. Mm. The knowledge transfer is not happening. So I would encourage, because I'm from engineering background, so all of us from engineering background. So I would encourage, like, we'll be having small courses in between, which is not for the marks, it's for the knowledge. True. So they can come and gather the knowledge, don't come for the marks, gather the knowledge, and it will be easy for you. Every year, it's not only the fourth year, I would recommend, like, it should be start from the first year.
That's true.
So every year they need to go and learn a new knowledge.
Correct.
And it is not for the marks, it is to gather the knowledge. So you need to bring the wisdom and knowledge from.
Sure. In fact, ma'am, I just want to take a minute extending from where Solomon left. Our interview process is very simple. We ask, we lay out a problem on the table to the candidate. We look at how they analyze the problem. Are they asking the right questions in analyzing the problem? And then we give them, ask them to estimate the time it takes for them to solve it and the type of solutions that they are offering. And we let them go. Like we, you can go back to your home, go back to your friends, build the solution and come back. And when they submit, how do they explain about the solution? How deep they have gone into the solution is where we decide whether this candidate is a good fit for us or not. Right? So having such an open interview kind of process has really worked for us. We have never gone with a job description in hand to find talent. Right? We look at a person, look at what they would like to offer, like what they would like to indulge in themselves in, and then you know, are we able to give them an opportunity to for them to explore that? That has kind of worked for us, and people are quite happy. In fact, one fun fact is that I told you we are approaching 500 as the headcount. Our employee number is a sequential number. We are at about probably 500, just above 500 as an employee count, and we have a 480 strong team, which means not more than 40-50 people have left the company in the last 7 years.
Wow.
Right? Tamil Nadu has culture where people believe, they give it time, they it's like what CSK does, right? Like CSK goes with experience. So we call ourselves as the CSK of Tamil Nadu in fintech. The reason for that is that we give people time and they pay us back in abundance, right? So that's really appreciable about the Tamil Nadu folks.
Yeah, clearly a great ecosystem to work in, but great pointers on how we can nurture the upcoming talent to make them fit for employment and fintech ready, and some great suggestions from your side that we don't make it marks oriented, but rather make it fun and learning oriented for the students so that they actually imbibe the skills. Thanks for that. Just for information, TIDCO and Tidal, these are our PSUs, the state PSUs, so they will be setting up what we are calling as Neo Tidals. These would also be like workspaces in the tier 2 cities, so we hope that this kind of infrastructure would help startups and fintechs to set up their workspaces in these locations. Just to move away, like I mentioned in the beginning, the state has always been home to a lot of banks, NBFCs, and given the kind of competition that the new age fintechs are posing to them, they are competing for similar kind of lending space. And so the traditional NBFCs, they are also now moving into the tech space. They are looking at tech to remain relevant. So how do you see the new age fintechs competing with the NBFCs, or how do you think that the two can either compete or merge or collaborate?
Sure. May I?
Yeah.
So I think we are very good at partnerships, ma'am. The kind of model why Chennai works for several banks is that if you look at the large banks like the HDFC as a bank or HDFC as a unit, they have their nerve centers based out of Chennai, right? A lot of their operations, their reconciliation, their MIS settlement kind of operations runs out of offices in Chennai. As I mentioned earlier, Chennai has a mix of both tech plus domain knowledge expertise available in a balance, right? Like hitting the right balance is the most important part of any problem for any company. So what has happened is that in this context, we do have several opportunities around not just around banking, around the companies that you mentioned, like NBFCs, lending as a company. Each of these companies were founded for a specific reason. They have their own roots. They have built their business with their roots in mind. But however, looking at the new age fintechs, they have kind of really opened up. They have started looking at how can we build a technology for Gen Z? How can we build a technology for the millennials? They have started partnering with new age fintechs. And most of the time, it's like a chicken and egg problem. If there are more regulated entities, there can be more innovation that can happen. Yes. And it should always be in a, again, this should also be in a balance. And I think both types of companies are required it's good for the end consumers. It is really, we have a lot of choice, we have a lot of competition. So I think both the entities will co-create a lot of products.
So, go ahead. My suggestion would be like, my thought will be like, we're not competing each other.
Right.
So we are on the same platform. And a fintech company is inventing some modules or anything, and old age NBFC banks or anyone, so they are ready to adapt it as well. And we are leveraging on the roots they have. So we are not inventing something out of nowhere. So we are also leveraging on the roots they have, and we are using the banking products inside our fintech. And it's like we are building an ecosystem. So previously banks was building the ecosystems and lending. People, they were building the ecosystem. So the fintech is also a part of building the ecosystem. And what benefit is like transparency is happening right now. And like if you have Slice credit cards now, we are talking of Slice credit cards. And getting a credit card, you don't have a credit score. It's very difficult. And I face, because as an entrepreneur, and I don't have a credit balance. So way back, I can remember like I was not able to get a credit card. But it's very easy for even a student to get a credit card and go and buy whatever he wants. So the ecosystem is changing, and we are building the ecosystem. So it's not like competing each other.
We complement each other.
Complement.
Right,
I think I agree with both Prabhu and Solomon. It's an age of collaboration. Today I remember a full page ad by Paytm Postpay. And actually if you see the asterisks, it says funded by Bajaj Finserv and Clicks Capital. So there's a technology in the front end. There is a bank or an NBFC at the bank end, and that's how things are progressing. I think in the interest of time, I will wrap with that. Back to you, ma'am.
Just the last piece before we move to seek questions. What is it that the state can do to improve the overall ecosystem or adoption of fintech amongst the general populace, so that we see more and more solutions being offered and more fintechs growing in the state?
Sure, ma'am. You want to say? All right. So I think we already have a mix of an accelerator kind of program in the form where Government of Tamil Nadu has and Government of India has already started an accelerator program. We need to have collaborative spaces where companies which have already built a product, which have certain which has attained certain amount of scale, they need to kind of take it as a corporate social responsibility to help the new age startups, give them access to these technologies, what they have built. Instead of creating walled gardens, can we open up, can we create more and more collaborative spaces, can we invite fresh talent, people with fresh ideas, can they come in and, you know, we should actually look at crowdsourcing technology. How can we get more hands to build a certain product? So that it also caters not just to Tamil Nadu or not just to India, it can cater to the entire world. Like we have seen in, with what Freshdesk and Zoho have done to the SaaS product play, we have potential to build several such startups across multiple domains, not just fintech, in insurtech, in wealth tech. We can build a lot of these products. So the key is to bring in collaboration. How can the government create an ecosystem of collaboration, where a lot of companies of varying sizes can come in and participate, give their two cents? That's a key, I think so.
I would say like the greatest thing that we need as a new age startup is knowledge sharing. Mm-hmm. So like intellect, if they can share the experience or the technology or the back end how they are using and to a startup. So we need to build a hub for knowledge sharing. It is not for students, but for new startups with established companies like Intellect or all banks. So it cannot happen without a government intervention, because government should call both of them into a room and ask them to discuss. So that is the support that we, because Prabhu was rightly pointing out here when we were discussing, that they have a blog in their website. They are not like giving the marketing aspects of their product. They are educating the people about the industry. What API is that? how we can leverage a virtual card, how you can bring out a virtual card. So it's educating and knowledge sharing. So that is important, and it should happen from all companies. Inside the CSR activity, knowledge sharing will be also an activity, and it should happen in Tamil Nadu.
Absolutely. So just to add, Intellect is doing a part. You mentioned about FinBlue being part of Chennai. Intellect is part of FinBlue. Our chairman is the chairman of FinBlue as well. Our assets are available as part of FinBlue. The sandbox has been created by Intellect, and open APIs are already available for most of the financial products. Key, as I picked up from what Solomon mentioned, is about mentorship. There are two types of mentorship as I see it. One, experience of how you scaled, how you built the company, sharing with new startups. The second is the reverse mentoring of new technologies that are coming can be shared with the already large enterprise. So both have a role to play. Okay, so thereby there is an interest. It's just not what am I giving, what am I also learning. When I go into that environment, that will help. When we started the session, we said FinTech is about bringing technology and domain together, and this can actually be expanded. I am sure EY paper, as well as when we started, that this is a large giant about to wake up and explode, is surely going to happen.
Yeah. Sure. So from the government side, of course, we are promoting the adoption of technology in the services that we ourselves provide, not just the general services, but also all financial services that government provides. That is how we look to improve adoption. All the transactions, as far as possible, bring it on a tech platform, try and encourage merchants to adopt FinTech in their businesses, and how that can make life easier for them. So these are some of the small things that we think we hope to take up in partnership with the FinTech sector in improving the pace of adoption itself. Gentlemen, it has been a very enriching conversation. I would now throw the floor open to questions, if any, for our panelists. Okay, so we have one question that is to me, I presume. So the question is, what can we expect from FinTech City in Chennai? Can we expect an SOP or a FinTech policy soon? So yes, we will be launching a FinTech policy very shortly. The draft is done and it is in the final in stages of approval. So we can see a FinTech policy very shortly. It will lay out roadmap for growth of FinTech in the state, a slew of incentives that the state would be offering, and the kind of infrastructure that the state would be developing, the various initiatives that the state would take to nurture talent and to create that ecosystem for FinTech in the state. We will be seeing this policy very shortly. FinTech City, the our sister concern TITCO is going to be floating a bid for developing the FinTech City very shortly at Nandambakkam. It would be a state-of-the-art facility with connectivity and the co-working spaces and whatever infrastructure that is required for not just startups, but also large-scale FinTech companies to set up their working locations in the city. That is what the city would offer. Mr. Solomon, we have a question for you. So the question is that the biggest challenge that you have faced during early days of your idea.
Okay, so I would say my biggest challenge is not building cash. My biggest challenge was when I was building my IT services as a fresher. So there are a lot of problems that I had, like people were not able to believe that a fresher can build a software or an enterprise software for them. But one thing that helped me was when I was doing my third year, there's a company called Sugula Pumps, we all know.
Yes.
So I developed a software, pump testing software for them. Wow. When I was doing the third year in VB 6.0. so the ecosystem is there. Only thing we need to like show that we have the knowledge to build that. So that is the only thing, because we step into entrepreneurship easily, but without gathering the knowledge. So that is the only, because when you have the knowledge, you are confident to build the product. So that is what I would recommend them.
Nice. There is another question for me. It's for Guidance. So how is Guidance Tamil Nadu attracting young people from South Tamil Nadu to involve them in startups? Are there any roadshows conducted? We have not conducted any roadshows as of now, but now that we have set up a cell in Guidance exclusively for fintech, this is definitely something that we will be taking up. We hope to network with you know, established fintech firms like like the promoters that you see here. You have Intellect Design, you have M2P, and young fintech firms like Cash. We would be networking with many more, and not just them, but also hopefully the funding ecosystem, to see what is it that young startups would require. And we hope to be bringing such roadshows to the tier 2 cities of the state, be it Coimbatore or Madurai, Tirunelveli, Tuticorin, Trichy, to all of these places. I already mentioned we would be also setting up these neo titles so that you can have affordable working spaces. And apart from that, we also intend to have the industry academia linkage. We would hope to tie up with engineering colleges across the state and provide them the learning spaces and the opportunities to upgrade their skills so that they are fintech ready. This is what we have in plan over the next 2 years. Thank you, gentlemen.
Thank you so much.
It has been a most interesting discussion, and from the government side, I have indeed learnt a lot as to what we can do and how we need to position ourselves. You are, of course, the best ambassadors for the city and the state to position the state as a fintech capital, not just in India, but South Asia as we go, and hopefully then of the world, not too far away. So wishing you all the very best, and hope to see Chennai and Tamil Nadu emerging as the global fintech hub. Thank you all. Thank you so much.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Pooja ma'am, and all other speakers, Mr. Prabhu, Mr. Ramanan, and Mr. Solomon as well. And definitely, Chennai, as we have always mentioned, has been a sleeping giant when it comes to fintechs and startups. And I think it is about time for the sleeping giant to, you know, turn a corner and start waking up. And thank you once again for this wonderful session. And with that, we will now move on to our next session.
5 minutes mein account set up aur trading shuru.
Haan, kar sakte hain.
Nahi kar sakte.
Lagi shart. Aur hara to. It's possible with CoinSwitch Kuber. Download karo aur Bitcoin trading start karo. CoinSwitch Kuber. Sikka chamkega.
Cryptocurrency is a non-regulated digital asset, not a legal tender, and subject to market risks and price fluctuation risk.
Where there is life, there is hope, there is meaning. But life has its downs as much as its ups. Life is about challenges. Life is about opportunities. Time for joy, time for celebration, and time to introspect. Thankfully, in every one of life's moments, and even beyond life itself, there's LIC. Where there is life, there's always LIC.